So you may have used one of my plugins, which are hosted on this site. So if you've seen that before but didn't know that was me, now you know. And that's the same name, Persistence, also my Twitter handle, which is also not necessarily obvious. I've been did a breakout session yesterday about QUnit and Test Swarm, which I hope by the next jQuery conference where I've got like a full session about. There's some really cool stuff going on there. I also work on jQuery UI, and the 1.9 beta is finally out, and so 1.9 final is not far away. But today, what I want to talk about is something really else. It's about single-page applications. And instead of reading out this definition from Wikipedia, I just want to show some examples. This is kind of probably the best-known example of a web application. And then by whatever definition of single-page application, that's probably a price here. Like, it's Gmail. It's a mail client running on the web, and you can fully control it with a keyboard if you enable the keyboard shortcuts. It's pretty awesome. But that's not necessarily something to aim for. Like, there's a lot of room between like a simple page that may have some interactions and a full-blown application like Gmail. Something I've worked on like half last year is the mobile SoundCloud website. If you don't know SoundCloud, it's best described as YouTube for audio. And what it basically does is it lets you listen to audio on the web, and anyone can upload stuff and share it with friends or share it with other people on the rest of the internet. And here on the screenshot on the left, you can see the player page with like a plays back audio, and you can see the progress with your waveform, which is kind of the icon of SoundCloud. And instead of just having the playback stop when you click on something else because you're looking for some other sounds, it'll just continue playing in the background. So on the screenshot on the right, you can see the now playing link at the top. If you would click on that, you get back to the player, and it's still active. So in this case, single page application makes a lot of sense because you want to have things go on in the background while you're still browsing content. Something else I worked on a few months ago is a control panel for a cloud hosting provider from Berlin. This is very different from what SoundCloud is doing, but it's an interesting application nonetheless. You can manage applications, deployments, deploy from Git to their cloud hosting service, can get statistics. It's a single page application, but otherwise doesn't really have that much in common with like SoundCloud or Gmail. But what both have in common is that they both basically a JavaScript application running on the client, and they use a JSON API. Here's a screenshot from Flickr's API documentation, which is probably one of the oldest and maybe best known JSON APIs. For the SoundCloud mobile site, we were using their API, and basically you can, for any user, you can get their tracks, or for a track you can get comments or stuff like that. It's basically like a wrapper around the database. And the database doesn't necessarily have to be like a single database. It can like come from different sources. Something else these two examples, like SoundCloud and this console, had in common, they were both using Backbone as a framework, along with jQuery and some other stuff, but for like structuring the application, figuring out what to load when and how to display it, Backbone was being used. This is certainly not the only framework, though when we started early 2011 on the SoundCloud mobile site, there wasn't that much choice, and even Backbone was still pretty early in development. But now there's Ember, which Yehuda is involved with, there's AngularJS, which like two people at Google are developing, and I didn't use any of them yet, so I can't really tell you that much about them. But what I can tell you, like using one of these frameworks can certainly make a huge difference compared to starting from scratch, especially if you haven't like built a full JavaScript application before. So with those in mind, the opportunities that I, like the title mentioned, opportunities, what are those? I argue that the first one is that this is pretty simple application architecture, because basically you have some static files, a JSON API on the server, and then you build your application on the client, and it can run on all these mobile web clients or browsers. You can get a better user experience because you can get rid of all the page reloads, and so other interactions that become possible that weren't really possible before, like playing audio in the background or whatever else you want to do. And there's interesting frameworks like Backbone and the others I mentioned. So that should sound pretty good, right? And see, I've got a few more of those. I don't know if they're as funny as Dave's, but I'm trying. First thing I want to mention of the like the pitfalls, which I'm not going to cover that much. You shouldn't underestimate what it means to build a full application in JavaScript. If so far you've basically like built stuff on the server and then you've sprinkled some jQuery on top, that's very different from doing everything in JavaScript. It's a whole new challenge. So listening to people who talk about application architecture, testing, all that stuff, or figuring out, like trying out these frameworks, it makes sense. It's definitely useful. But that's not what I'm going to cover here. Instead, I want to cover like a few of these opportunities and see what pitfalls there are. To start with, the first third will be basically about why hashbang sucks and what you should use instead, why having a first page load being really slow is not good, and what you should do about error handling. And for all of these, I have examples. I will show some of the code, but not all of them. But nonetheless, the code is all on GitHub, so I'll give you the link later on. So if you want to see the examples in detail and try them out yourself, play around with them, you can do that later. So to start with this first one, this, user experience really getting better, because there's actually some room for making it worse. So I'll give you an idea of that. Here's our fake classic page, which is like just a regular website. There's a link there where you can see kitten details. So if you click on that, you get kitten details. It's just a placeholder, but the important part here is the red underline here, the slash details. So the address change. Because it's just a link and the browser loads another page, the address changes. Let's say we built that from scratch as a single application using Backbone and whatever else. And we've got the same link, and then we load some details. Maybe the details load via AJAX, but we get JSON back and then show something. And if we aren't careful or don't pay attention or don't use a framework that already handles that for us, we end up with just the same URL. So it doesn't change. Even though the content changes, the URL stays the same. And as little and subtle as that may look like, it's actually a pretty big problem. Because it means if we now click on the back button, nothing happens. Maybe we get to the page like the Google search result or something, but we don't get to the start page again. If we go back and like do a command or control click, depending on the system, to open that link in a new tab, which pretty much works everywhere, it would just do the same thing as a regular click. So we break like native behavior, which is not a good thing, because the few things that people learn about how browsers work, if we break those expectations, we actually make things worse. And one more thing, by actually addressing this problem, we open up a few other opportunities that I'll get to like in the second part. But for now, let's look at some HTML, specifically the HTML5 history API that can help us address this problem. Before we look at the API and the details for that, here's a chart from caniuse.com, a pretty awesome site showing you support for all kinds of new features in browsers. As you can see, IE will support in IE10 the history API, but current browsers don't. So we may need a fallback there. But actually, we can get away with not doing it. I'll talk about that in the next part. And Android 4 and 3 have kind of a broke implementation, but they're now going to replace the crappy browser anyway with like Chrome on Android. So that's kind of getting addressed as well. So overall, the support is pretty good. Like, there's other HTML5 features where the situation is much worse. But we still need some workarounds and some bug fixes, because the vendors can't really agree on some details of the spec. So if we look at those options, here's a quick overview of the API, which is actually really simple. There's the push state method, which when you call that, we'll use that fragment that you provide as the last argument. There's two others, which are mostly completely irrelevant, but they made it into the spec, and now they can't remove it. But what this does is add a new history entry to the history stack and change the address, which is something that there's no way to like do that with JavaScript without the browser supporting it. So you can't really, like, you can't write a true polyfill for that. So that's why it was so frustrating for IE9 not to support that, because the API is really simple. There's an alternative replace state, which also changed the address, but that does not add a history entry, just replace the current one. There are a few edge cases where that is useful, but like push state is really the important method here. And in order to know when, for example, the user presses the back button, we can listen to the pop state event. And that's where the inconsistencies start, because like Mozilla thinks that everyone else is wrong about how when the pop state event should be triggered, and everyone else thinks Mozilla is wrong, and they so far couldn't agree on one way or the other. So we have to deal with some inconsistency there. So libraries can actually help address those. History.js is one from Benjamin Balupton. He's an Australian, and he wrote this really comprehensive library that pretty much covers all the things there are. Probably addresses by now too many bugs that we don't even care about, more like some regression in Chrome 4, whatever. No one uses that anymore. If you use Backbone, you should opt into the push state support that got landed like about a year ago. That makes a lot of sense. And what I'm going to use in the example tab here, something I actually wrote for this talk, it's called Simple History.js, which is just a thin wrapper around the API, just getting rid of the few inconsistencies, but not doing like hash change fallbacks. And not being a framework of its own. It's really just a small, really small library. And the API is pretty simple to what the original history API looks like. So push state, replace state are pretty much the same, except they get rid of the completely useless title argument. And instead of binding to a pop state event with add event listener, you just pass a callback to the start method. And that'll deal with the normalization of the pop state event. So if you've never like seen push state before, I want to show you an example of what that actually looks like in practice. Let's see if I can get this running without falling back to cloning. All right. And just to get this. Okay, so I've got this really simple application here. And in order for you to believe me that this is actually like running stuff as a single page application, not just reloading a page, I've got this audio element here, which should play back when I click on play. So can like if you keep an eye on that, you can see it's running. And if I now click on one of the images, like this is basically a gallery application, it will continue running. So and I can go back. And still the same thing. So it's actually replacing content in the client. But if I do that again, you can see that the URL here actually can change. Like it's just a regular URL. There's no hash involved. It's a separate address. And as you can see, I can use the back button to go back. So this is basically what the push state API is about. Once you understand that, it's really stupid simple, but it's extremely useful and something that makes building these type of applications a lot more pleasant. And we can just like reload the page and we get the same page again, and the same thing also works fine on iOS. So again here, should be able to play back the audio thing. Maybe not. Let's see. Okay, so audio also works, and again it can change the address and can see it updated, and if I go back, it's still playing back the audio. Except now it doesn't show it anymore. Yeah, so like the native audio element, you probably shouldn't use it, but good enough for this demo. So the code involved in that, it's two pieces I want to quickly show you. So this deals with handling clicks. So it assumes that your anchors on the page just point to regular URLs. You don't make anything special for this JavaScript application, just regular URLs. And whenever we click on one of these, we ignore everything that points to some like other server, but if it's in, like a local click, we'll handle it. And the first thing to check is if the event has like this meta key, shift key, or control key property set, which basically means the user is trying to do something special. So let's ignore that. So just let the browser handle. So that actually makes the control click work like it's supposed to. Otherwise, we prevent the default, just calling event default. And then call his simple history push state, passing the href of that link we just clicked. And that's all. The actual handling of what to show next is handled elsewhere. So elsewhere in the code, you'll find this call to the start method. And when you do that, whenever push state or the pop state event is triggered, then your callback is run. And you can use the UL argument to figure out what are you supposed to show next. So it's basically you take the URL, do some client-side routing, and figure out what content to show. In this case, the actual application is really stupid simple. It basically just figures out, this is the index page. If show, show that. Otherwise, show an image. If show an image, use this photos.lookup call to just update an image element. It's just an example, nothing like production ready, but it does the trick. So I mentioned hash changes before and that they're actually not such a great idea. And you're most likely to have seen them on Twitter for a year now or something. So whenever you go to twitter.com/persistence, you will end up on this /hash bang/persistence, which is actually pretty annoying because when you reload that page, it'll like open the Twitter homepage and then figure out, hey, there's a hash and I should actually load something else because the hash part is never available on the server without doing some JavaScript workarounds. So it might be okay to use as a fallback, but you probably shouldn't even do that. So I'll show you soon. And I had this chance to talk to Dan Webb, who basically was responsible at Twitter for like undoing all the hash change stuff on Tuesday. And they actually figured out that they don't want to have the hash change, not even as a fallback. So Twitter doesn't do that anymore. So, and explain why that actually works. So, but what you keep in mind, use push state and try to not even bother with hash change. So, but then we have this other thing about the first page load. Like, really, does it have to take 10 seconds or 15 seconds to load like a Twitter status update where it's just 140 characters? That shouldn't take that long. And as this guy says, if you like load a page, then you should make a good impression. So, and what it comes down to is going back to the server and rendering content on the server, which may sound like a bad idea because now our simple application architecture actually gets not so simple because now we have to do things on the client and on the server. So, but it actually, it's not even that bad because there are few opportunities to make use of this dual thing. On the one hand, assuming that you have this JSON API already, just use it on the server. Like, there's no reason why your server should use a different API from your client. Just use the same thing, and you basically just have less network latency in between. Whenever you have like templates, it should be just a matter of HTML with a few placeholders, so there's no reason why you shouldn't be able to render those on the server as well. And what, where it gets even more interesting, if you have a platform on the server that also runs JavaScript, you might even be able to share a lot more code with the client. And luckily, we now have Node.js, and while this isn't the official logo, I like it much more. We can actually run this stuff on the server just as, and share code between client and server. And again, I'll switch to showing you a quick example. And for that, it's basically just show the same stuff that before. This time around, I'll show you the source of each page. So just to reload once. And then this thing about view source here is it's always rendering stuff from the server. So you don't, it doesn't show any DOM modifications. So what you can see here is pretty much just like the list of images. And then below here is this placeholder with an empty image element. Might be not such a great design, but it makes it like the JavaScript update this makes it pretty simple. Now if we go back, click on one of these links and you view source again, it still renders it that same list because it was lazy, but the difference is now we'll actually have the image element in the markup again. So and because it's the same stuff on the coming down from the server, just with content this time around, we can still just use that and modify it from JavaScript. So if I go back and load another page, it'll just use that same image element and put something else in there. And I'm going to skip over the Node parts of this. Like if you've worked with Node.js before, it would probably be pretty boring. If you had never seen it before, probably like showing you just a few code slides probably wouldn't help either. So again, the code is available on GitHub. What I'm going to show here is just a bit of JavaScript that is explicitly shared between the two sites here. So you can see this if type of exports not equal to undefined. This is basically detecting, hey, we're running in a Node.js environment because Node has this export object. So let's use that to export our like data and methods. And otherwise, it'll just declare a new variable, in this case, just global, and export stuff through that. So in the end, we can use that same photos.lookup method both on the client and server, which in this case is not extremely helpful because it's just doing some filtering, but again this is just an example. So in the actual application, you might be able to share a ton of code between client and server. And instead of trying to figure out all of that from scratch, there's actually quite a few frameworks available now that are explicitly about, let's build this application once and run it both on the client and server. I haven't used any of them, so I can't really talk much about that. But along with this, all the example source codes, I also have a list of links where you can find a few of these. But for now, let's just keep in mind, server-side rendering can be really helpful to address the slow first page load. And that's pretty much what Twitter is doing. Like in IE, they just always have like server-side rendering. They basically don't do much anymore on the client, which also actually helps address stuff like search engine optimization, where someone comes up, hey, we've got this single page application, the hash change, and Googlebot doesn't see our content. So rendering content on the server means you don't have to do anything special for that stupid crawler. That said, what could possibly go wrong? And I've got a little illustration here. Except this is not the quote I was looking for, so I adapted that slightly. In browsers, no one can hear your code scream. Basically, when this happens, like something throws up, this might happen, except it's like the tree falling in the forest when no one is looking. You don't see it, and your client probably won't, like your users don't look at the console to see what your application is doing, except they happen to be app developers. So what can we do about that? Like, this is actually a big deal, because whenever something goes wrong, you won't know about it. Your client might complain, maybe not, maybe it just goes on to your competition. So it's really important to deal with error handling, which is basically catch errors on the client, send them back to the server, to your server or some third-party server. And if you get a lot of these errors, you actually have to deal with aggregation. To get back to in a little bit, to start, what type of errors do we have to deal with? There's syntax errors in JavaScript, which should be really easy to catch even before any of your users see your application. So if you like test locally and then like build your applications, maybe some JavaScript modification, deploy it to a staging server or even to your live server and take a look yourself, if there's something really wrong, you get a syntax error and you'll notice. So nothing we really have to worry about at runtime. Though what we have to worry about is type errors, because those are much more likely to occur. And there's some random conditions which we can't necessarily test for. So dealing with those is pretty important. And the same goes about AJAX errors, which depends, like can depend a lot of network, but it might also be just like user mistyped a URL. Our server may have something, maybe doing something wrong, which we don't know about. So being aware at least of what errors occur and then deciding to ignore certain errors, that's also important. Here's some little code snippet to test, like an AJAX and a type error, because the AJAX request is actually asynchronous. The 404 that this causes will come afterwards. And so let's see how we can handle the type errors. And while I generally try to avoid the term best practice, I think this is pretty much at least the best current practice on handling errors. You should not use jQuery's bind or on method to bind to error event, because you actually lose those three arguments, message, file, and line, which are really, really useful. Just knowing that an error occurred is completely useless if you don't have any context about it. And you may notice the first line in the handler itself actually kills itself. So if like something in a loop occurs, we only get notified about it once. Otherwise, a single client may spam our logging service, which is generally not useful. You can do the same thing with AJAX errors. Of course, you're assuming that you use jQuery and using the one method to bind just a single AJAX error event, and then just using the arguments that you get to log an error. And the log error method that these two were using could look like this, again, using jQuery to just post something back to the server, which, of course, won't work when the network is down. So if you're dealing with AJAX errors that are triggered by an AJAX like network problem, then sending back to the same server probably won't help. I'll skip the example here because it's not really that interesting. But what I want to talk a little bit more about is the aggregation options. So I mentioned before, like, if you're dealing with it like that cloud hosting application, there's like another 20 people using that right now. So there's not a lot of errors. So aggregation is not really important, but on the other hand, with Sun.mobile, which like went from 70,000 to like 200,000 views per day, we ended up with a few thousand errors at a few days. So like figuring out which of those are the same and which are unique and which should we deal with, that turned out to be pretty important. So either you just roll your own solution, or if you're using something like Google Analytics or some other analytics software, you may be able to use that. So for example, by triggering custom events, which are kind of like jQuery custom events, except with its analytics tools. And if you want to use that, here's an adapted log error method, which uses Google Analytics weird array-based API, where the first argument is basically a method call, so we want to track an event, and then we just pass on these other arguments, and we can actually, like this was supposed to have a screenshot, what that looks like. Sorry. Other tools available are, for example, Airbrake and BugSense. Those are third-party service, mostly about tracking errors from your server-side application, but you can actually use them to track client-side errors as well. Here's a screenshot from Airbrake. And again, along with the code examples, I've got a few resources. There's someone at Sound that did write a blog post about how we were using, I think, both, like covering both Airbrake and BugSense for doing this kind of logging. But whatever you end up using, it's the most important point is to actually catch all those errors and figuring out how to deal with them. So that said, is that all worth the trouble? And to recap, like the better user experience by removing page reloads, as long as you pay attention to other things that you might break in the process and fix those, we can get a better user experience. And we can still make a good first impression if that's important for our particular application, which is not always the case. For Twitter, it obviously is. For others, it might not be. But it's generally a good idea to have a first good first page load. And if we deal with errors, we can also provide a pretty stable product. So yeah, I think it's worth it. And with that, I'm pretty much done. Yeah, so here are the links for the examples. There's something I forgot here. If you got feedback for this particular talk, I'm welcome to have any feedback for this survey or just ping me on Twitter or send an email. And we have like 6 minutes left for questions. So if you have any, let me know.
I have a question about the error handling.
I can see you, but oh, right there.
So the in JavaScript, if you catch the exception, will it still be caught by the window when you do it on error? So if a JavaScript developer is trying to prevent the console from logging the exception to be visible to the user, would it still be caught and sent to the server?
So if you, like, if all your code is wrapped in a try block and you catch all exceptions, then no, it won't bubble up. So if you have a try block and catching all exceptions, then the global handler will. But if you have that try block in place, you might as well just use the catch block to block the error instead of having it bubble up. So that shouldn't make that much of a difference. Just the approach to how to deal with the errors is slightly different. But generally, I think it's not a really good idea to have everything wrapped in a try block, because if you're dealing with like modern JIT engines like V8, they actually opt out of a lot of optimizations if you have everything in a try block. So that's generally not such a great idea.
So I think you mentioned that Twitter has figured out a way to avoid using the hash bang hack, but I don't know that you mentioned what that method is. I wonder if you could share that with us.
So what they're basically doing now is they don't use hashbang anymore. And if they like find a hash on the client that's supposed to be like the old style URL, they just rewrite that to a proper URL. And they don't have the hash change fallback at all, which basically means if you use Twitter, at least as soon as they actually done with those changes, on like IE9, it'll basically do fallback to always do server-side rendering. And because they actually optimize for that to some degree, it's pretty fast anyway. So it's not that much of a difference. And like Twitter doesn't have to play big audio in the background, so they don't really care about IE9 not supporting hash change. Not supporting push state.
So I'm actually working in a full request environment, and I've been switching over, and right now I'm kind of in a hybrid environment where some pages have our single page applications, but I have multiple like small single page applications.
Okay.
And I've been wondering about, you said Twitter, they do a single page app, but it also falls back, the back end will serve up the entire thing. I was wondering if there's any like good solutions out there to help. It seems like you have to get a lot of communication, or are you almost doubling all your code that you would have had on the front end on the back end so that you can have this fallback behavior, or if somebody renders the page? And I was wondering if there's any good solutions or ways to make that a little bit smoother for me.
So there are frameworks available that basically help you like share the code. So like I think one is like Meteor.js, which is basically all about writing stuff once and then having it run on both sides. I think what Twitter is now doing is basically when you click on the like push state enabled link, they actually send more or less the same request that it would otherwise send to the server with a regular request, and that looks at the headers, sees, hey, this is HTTP request, so let's only send like the body of the page and skip the headers and stuff. And they just dump that into the page. And they even, I think what they also do is use the push state argument to just reference this blob of HTML, and if you use the back button, it will actually load that content again. So they basically just use the same, like they don't even render templates on the client, they just render them all those in the server and use AJAX to load them. Which is, it's probably a pretty simple solution, so that's generally a good idea. But then Twitter is not necessarily the typical single page application either.
So I have a question that I'm hoping you can help me with. How tall are you?
I don't know in foot or inches because we don't use that silly system in Germany. 194.
Very.
I think that's it. So one more round of applause for Jorn.